10 estate, and then we go down to 7 out of 30,000 for the 202 estate. And if you want to explain this by classical means, by just, you know, coming up with some cross sections and describe electron atom scattering, you cannot explain these results. So we had to get involved with the theory of excitations in the condensate itself in order to explain this nicely. And that brings us now to the coupling of the single electron to the superfluid, to the Bose-Einstein condensate, in terms of Bode-Ubov excitations. So for this, you should remember now that in a condensate, you don't have only free atoms. Yeah, a free atom basically has a quadratic dispersion relation. As soon as these atoms have an interaction, there are collective excitations called phonons, density wave, that have a linear dispersion. Okay. So in the dispersion relation in the Bose-Einstein condensate, you typically start out with a linear dispersion relation that actually for large momentum turns over in a quadratic dispersion relation because the interaction energy is limited. There's a length scale, that's this healing length associated with this, and along with this length scale comes a momentum, and up to this inverse healing length, basically you have collective behavior, phonon excitation, and beyond this you have a basically free particle dispersion relation. Yeah. Okay, and now we have to think about what we actually did. We have a condensate with a dispersion relation that looks like this, where phonon waves can propagate, and we are sort of dipping in a perturber, a Rydberg perturber, a Rydberg electron with a certain wave function. Yeah, so actually, I like to do Pov ray things, as some of you might have realized. This was a long flight to Japan, and so I did some animation of this. So this is supposed to show you a S-state Rydberg atom that is put into a fluid, a superfluid, that excites some waves now in the condensate. Okay, and we want to describe this process that ultimately leads to a loss of atoms from the condensate in the appropriate way. Now, you can have a very naive approach and say, we have this potential that I showed you, you know, these wiggles of the electron density multiplied by the scattering length, and this Rydberg perturber, this potential now, lives in the condensate for its lifetime, tau, okay? And it will leave it will couple sort of to this condensate with a certain strength that is just given by scattering length times density divided by mass, 4 times tau. And now as we are just basically in the regime where this interaction is short, the evolution, just like in the Rabi problem, basically starts quadratically. So that's why the initial guess that you might have is that this loss basically goes like coupling strength times the time squared, times, of course, the number of atoms that are in the Rydberg orbit. Okay. And basically, this is not such a bad idea. If you really want to do it quantitatively, you have to, of course, do the Bode-Ubov theory correctly, which is shown here. I don't want to go too much into this right now. I just want to mention that basically what you need to consider now is that you have this perturber that has a potential, and in order to decide whether you excite phonons or free particles, you have to Fourier decompose this potential and ask the question, how much of these, what is the weight of the Fourier components in the phonon regime, and what is the weight of the Fourier components in the free particle regime? And this is basically plotted here. One is the inverse healing length, so everything on the left side, one here, is basically in the phonon regime, and on the right side is in the free particle regime. And so what you get from that is that we are in this sort of mixed situation where we are exciting phonons, but we are also exciting free particles if you do this. Okay, and if you do this do the Ogilvie theory with 10 microsecond lifetime, constant lifetime, you can predict these losses. Now we normalize to tau squared because everything scales with this lifetime squared here. And basically, this theory explains nicely what we see. These are our experimental measurements on the losses as a function of principal quantum number. And if we take the measured lifetimes, which are actually slightly different, into account, the agreement is even better. So we do have some confidence now that this single electron, this single Rydberg electron, is coupling to these to BEC excitations, and the very low momentum components of this coupling are actually the ones that are responsible for setting the whole condensate into motion. Now, another way to visualize this is to ask your theory friends, in this case Kazi Georgievsky and Mirek Bevcik's group, to just solve the Gross-Pitayevsky equation, so the nonlinear Schrödinger equation, with this perturber brute force. Yes, you just have a grid calculation, and you put a Rydberg atom where there is this black dot, and see what happens. Okay. And now I'm going to play this movie for you, and you will see that there are many black dots coming up one after the other, because in the experiment, of course, we are doing many pulses. Yeah, so there's not only a single Rydberg, there's one Rydberg, but then there's the next one, and the next one, and the next one, and the position of those excitations is not well controlled in our experiment. Okay. So if you now watch this, you see that every Rydberg atom here leaves a trace in the condensate in form of a density wave, which is just what I said in other terms in the Bogle-Jubert language, namely that there is a density wave that is now spreading, basically, after excitation. And you can see that this is an S state, Rydberg atom, yes, it's completely round. It scrambles up the density distribution in the condensate, and now you have to take those pictures. You run the calculation for our experimental parameters, take those pictures and convert such a scrambled condensate into a loss of atoms after some time of flight. And that's what they did. So here's again our experimental points, and the red points are their theoretically calculated points. Now, this time not with Bogle-Yubov in a homogeneous system, but in the finite system, fully calculating the Gross-Pitayevsky equation. And also there, the agreement is actually surprisingly good. Okay, so this basically summarizes what I wanted to say about this extreme case of having huge Rydberg atoms and combine those huge Rydberg states with the condensate. Oh, there's another... Is it? Ah, yeah, there's another little porphyry where you see if you increase n, then the Rydberg atom increases. If you have 100, then you have many atoms inside. If you go up to 200, then the Rydberg atom is as large as the whole condensate. Anyway, so what is the essence now? I mean, what have we, what is this new system, I would say, that we have available now? It is basically an electron trap. The Rydberg atom for us is just an electron trap. That's one way of putting this. Keeping the electron in the condensate and letting it interact with the condensate for a finite time. We know that it's only a single one because the blockade effects, the blockade radius is much larger than everything here. And then we can watch basically the single electron interact with this condensate and see that the condensate is actually excited about this. Now, the fact that there are so many atoms inside the ground state, inside the Rydberg orbit now, is not the new thing. And that brings me back to the history again. If I show you this abstract in the, well, I should say the whole paper is just one column, I think, in 1934 of Amaldi and Segret. But already in their abstract, they write that for their large principal quantum number, which was like 35 in their case, but remember, they go all the way up to ambient pressure, they have already observed that there can be on the order of 10,000 background gas atoms inside the Rydberg orbit. So this is not the new thing of our measurement. Yeah, this is known, although we had to rediscover this, but this is known since 80 years now. What is really new now is, of course, that we can control a single excitation and study its coupling to the condensate. And so, in terms of maybe this many-body physics, there are many options now open, and I'm happy to discuss with all of you what might be your ideas. One thing is, we have just excited S state atoms. We can, of course, also excite D state atoms. And if they do the simulation for this, you can recognize the shape of this wave function just in the density of the condensate. Right? I mean, the picture that you should have is that basically the Rydberg wave function provides a potential. The ground state atoms flow into this potential, and then if you take a picture, you can image the wave function of a single electron. Well, the wave function squared, of course, right? And so wouldn't it be nice to just take such a picture of, say, a D-state electron? That's something we are working on. Then you can ask, well, is there a way to study interactions that are mediated by the phonon coupling? And there is. If you have a sequence with two pulses following each other, then the first pulse might influence the position of the second spectrum or the second pulse, just due to the density change and this density shift, basically. Right? So phonon-mediated electron-electron interaction can possibly be studied. Another interesting thought is that, of course, this condensate is optically thick, and now actually we have not only a Rydberg blockade, we also have a Coulomb blockade, yeah, because even the whole object inside the Rydberg orbit, if you think about the extreme situation where the electron is completely out of the condensate, even this object inside here is optically thick, and this single charge that you're putting there is preventing any further excitation. And of course, this Coulomb blockade is stronger than the dipole-dipole blockade. So that might be an interesting direction to go. Another interesting direction is to really bring the electron completely out of the condensate. I mean, there's a simple reason for us, actually, because we ultimately we really want to understand where this decay process comes from. And if you bring the electron out of the condensate, we should either see very long lifetimes, then the decay comes from the electron, or we should see the same lifetimes, then the decay comes from the ion. Yes. Because the ion, of course, has to stay behind in the high density region. So to discriminate those two things, you better bring the electron out and keep the ion in. But of course, there are much more fascinating things than just measuring the loss process. One question that you can ask is, how about the residual interaction of the ion now with the condensate? And for this, I have another slide here. Of course, there are a lot of people that are studying ions in condensates. What they are doing, for example, Michael Kühl, Johannes Hecker-Benschlag, and so on, is building Powell traps and combine them with traps for Bose-Einstein condensates. There's a picture here. Now, why do they do this? I mean, the point is, of course, this time the charge in comparison to the electron has a much higher mass. It's 10 to the 5 times more heavy than the electron. The scattering length is such that basically it's comparable now to the mean particle spacing. So we are no longer in this regime where the range of interaction, like for the electron, that's always the case, yeah, where the range of interaction is much smaller than the mean particle spacing. It's just the opposite, actually, or actually they are comparable, yes? The mean particle spacing in the condensate and the range of interaction of a ion interacting with ground state atoms is comparable with the mean particle spacing. However, the absolute interaction strength then scales with the mass as well. So whereas we see shifts here of 10 megahertz, for them this will be actually much smaller, yes, much smaller effects. And in addition, they will have to work at extremely low temperatures, like below 1 microkelvin. Otherwise, they are not in the S-wave scattering regime. And as they are working with Powell traps, they are very far from this regime, actually, yes, because in the Powell trap, the ion is always rattling around due to micromotion, and typically right now they are in the 1 millikelvin or so regime. So far away from the interesting regime. So we could, just to contrast what we have done now is, we have an electron mass, of course. Just talk about the electron. We are in this weakly interacting regime. Yeah? The length scale of the interaction is much smaller than the interparticle spacing. But the absolute interaction strength goes like 1, and scattering length times now the inverse of the electron mass. And that's a huge interaction energy. Now, going back to this picture here, if I take the electron out of the condensate, then I might, you know, ask what is the effect of the ion, and it will be reduced actually by the square root of the mass ratio, but it's still sizable on the scale of a condensate, of course, it's still sizable. So one can even dream about trapping the ion in the condensate. Just build an ion trap by a dense condensate where the ion is just trapped by the attractive interaction between the ground state atoms and the single ion. And that's one direction that we are also following. Okay, I skip this. How much time am I doing in time?
A few minutes.
A few minutes. Okay, we can continue the discussion later on. I just wanted to also touch upon this Rydberg dressing idea, which is of course also interesting in this regime if you combine Rydberg excitation with Bose-Einstein condensates. Now, typically, timescales for Bose-Einstein condensates and for these Rydberg experiments are quite different. Yeah, and in order to see a collective oscillation or something in a condensate, everything happens on the trap frequency scale or so, yeah, so which takes milliseconds, long times, basically, on the time scale of a Rydberg lifetime, which is 10 microseconds or something like this, right? So then there's this very strong interaction between Rydberg atoms, and you might like to use this, yeah, to enlarge your toolbox of interactions that you have in the field of ultra-cold gases. And so there's this idea of dressing, so dress states, yeah, number two here, dressing the ground state with a little bit of Rydberg state, such that the fraction in the Rydberg state is actually so small that the effective lifetime becomes comparable to the time scale of a condensate. Yes? So if you have a little bit of Rydberg, this is a factor beta, so this beta must be small, such that the lifetime of this Rydberg dressing setup becomes comparable to the time scales of a condensate. So if you say you want to have this effect working for like 100 milliseconds, and you have a 10 microsecond time scale, then this beta squared must be 10 to the minus 4, or the beta itself must be 10 to the minus 2. So a 1% admixture of Rydberg should be tolerable, basically, in terms of lifetime. And then you might ask, okay, what is the interaction energy that is remaining? If you plug in, you have all these nice van der Waals curves in mind with these C6 coefficients that go up like n to the 11 and so on, huge interaction energies, typically interaction energies on the order of megahertz or even larger, yes, are possible, and you multiply by 10 to the minus 4, then you still have a very strong interaction on the energy scale of a condensate, which is kilohertz typically. So this is an intriguing idea, right? Why not try and look into this problem? Okay, and I just want to tell you that we tried this for some time, and there are some problems. And this is a school, and usually if you have a failure in the lab, you don't talk about this in a conference, but at a school, you maybe should talk about or at least discuss. Because if your supervisor one day comes and says, "Wow, there's this great idea, we should do this," you should ask tough questions. Yes? What is a tough question in this business here? What would you think is a tough question here? Why is it not working so nicely? Do you have any idea? No? It sounds nice, right? I mean, it sounds perfect. Yeah? I was really very much intrigued by this. Well, let's look at, this is dress states. I have three levels now. This time it's pair states, okay? So think of two ground state atoms sitting at a certain distance, one excited state that you are coupling by light field, so it's actually this positive superposition of GR plus RG divided by square root of 2, and the interacting Rydberg-Rydberg pair state. Okay. So this is the pair state basis we are going to work in, and then we are coupling this by a dressing field, by some omega here. Okay. And diagonalize this. All right. So these are the bare states, and the Rydberg state has this U of R. So that's the very strong interaction you want to benefit from, yes? So it goes huge, it's like this is thousands of kilohertz, yes? It's very large, yes? But then if you do the diagonalization, you see something like this. This is the interatomic distance, and you see that in contrast to what you expected, this dashed line goes up like f squared u, this effect quickly levels off. And why is this? Well, the reason is there is a blockade. There's a Rydberg blockade. So if the atoms are too close, the two of them cannot be excited to this double R state and therefore cannot interact anymore. Okay, so the effective two-body potential under the influence of this dressing looks like this red curve. There's also another case here where you have a resonance, but effectively it looks like this. Okay, so that's the first big problem here, yes, that there is a blockade that is basically reducing the effect. Well, we looked into this some time ago and decided, well, it should still work, yes.
Why is this a problem?
Well, because the strength is not going up here, yes. It's sort of leveling off. Now, you might...
It's just life, right?
That's life, you say. Okay, yeah. Good. So, how can you understand this now? And there we come to, again, dress states, optical light shifts. Out here, you have a shift due to the coupling of those two atoms to the light field. They are coupling independently. So it's just twice the light shift in this dressing field. That's the asymptotic level U1 here. Inside here, you also get a light shift. And it's actually the light shift of a so-called super atom with two atoms inside now. Okay. So what does it mean? A super atom has a Rabi frequency that is square root of n times omega, so here n is 2. So the only difference in the light shift is that there is this little factor of 2 here. Yes? Otherwise, it's a single atom light shift, but now, of course, distributed among two atoms. That's sort of the other level. And turns out, this energy difference is what you care about. Now, it doesn't really matter a lot, you know, but what is your Rydberg-Rydberg interaction anymore? Yeah, Rydberg-Rydberg interaction just determines where is this blockade radius, where is this step radius, but this is not varying a lot, actually. So it turns out the whole Rydberg dressing is just light shifts that are ultimately blocked at some distance. Okay. And you can have a repulsive and attractive version, you can have resonant versions of this. What I want to say is now, if you go and take this picture serious and go into a higher density regime, then, so you generalize this, then you say, okay, the asymptotic values of the potential are U1 of n is just n times the single atom light shift here, and the inner part is the N super atom light shift, which has n omega squared here, distributed over n atoms. Okay. If you take this difference, that's the only energy that you can gain from dressing, actually. If you take this difference and divide by n, because that's the number, I mean, the whole effect is then distributed among n atoms, you come up with a dressing energy. So it's just taking those two formulas, writing the difference and divide it by n. And I have then introduced here already some other notation where the blockade radius comes in, the density, the fraction of Rydberg atoms, and so on. This is now going too far. I think we're running out of time. Now you can easily derive an energy functional, basically, as a function of the density now, that you just plug in into your Gross-Peter-Jevsky equation to calculate the effect on a condensate. So if you take this energy functional and plot it as function of density, you see that, okay, it quickly saturates to some value that is actually just given by your laser power squared, actually, yes. So it's omega to the fourth power divided by delta 3. And what the initial excitement was, basically, that the the density effect, the linear expansion of this density effect would lead to a dramatic change of the effective scattering length of atoms in the condensate, which just goes as an energy then linear in the density. That's the case, but only for extremely small densities. And you start to see the deviation at the moment where you have two ground state atoms sitting at the distance of the blockade radius. Now, the blockade radius for us is like 10 microns, something like this. So if you consider densities in a condensate, I mean, we are far off. Yeah? So this is 10 to the 12, 10 to the 13 atoms. So BEC is over here. And you might ask, well, maybe there is still some effect. Yes, maybe there is a tiny effect, and just at least to try hard and see whether we can do it. Let's do a calculation for the shape of the condensate. And here you see the result of such a calculation. And you see for 10 to the 4 and 10 to the 5 atoms, okay, for lower density, of course, smaller atom number effect is larger. You can see huge changes in the shape distribution. Or in the, if you go to like 10 to the 5 atoms, changes are already marginal, getting smaller. Yes. So then if you ask, how large is this effect? Actually, I should say the major effect is actually happening in the center. It's just basically the peak density that is a little bit reduced. Yeah? Because in the wings, there's also something happening, but it's very hard to distinguish this from beyond Thomas Fermi approximation effects. So the only sort of figure of merit that one can look at is maybe peak density in the center. And that's what we are calculating here, Rabi frequency, detuning, and then you see this is percent effect. If the Rabi frequency is sort of on the order of 10 kilohertz. Yeah? So that's a two-photon Rabi frequency now, and that's the detuning. Yeah? So if you can work like at 10 kilohertz, 100 kilohertz detuning, then you should see a like 10% change in the central density in a normal condensate. That's sort of borderline. I show you some measurements that show you, okay, we tried hard. And if you really go into the Rydberg lines now, and then you see, of course, these lines. I mean, if you really want to go to like 100 kilohertz detuning, there are many other things happening. For example, on the D state here, you see molecular lines coming up, density shifts. In a nutshell, I mean, out of this noise, we did not conclude that we observed anything on the dressing. All right, so this is my last slide for today, summarizing this again. I commented in the end a little bit about Rydberg dressing, which was done at lower principal quantum numbers, but in the BEC regime here. And I also showed you that we can go all the way up to n equals 200 and couple the single electron to the condensate. Thank you.